So we're continuing this morning with the marks of a true Christian, where we have been studying what Paul said a true Christian should look like, should embody, the marks that would distinguish the Christian from regular folks of his day, that would be the identifying factors. So they're not necessarily prescriptive, like laws would be commanding how we should be living, but instead are descriptive of how people could be living in the grace, basking in the grace of what Paul has set forth as the gift of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. This is the type of person made possible by the grace of Jesus Christ. So the challenge is each week to hold a mirror up to our faces, not to condemn ourselves for failing to live up to them, but instead to inspire us to try, to seek, to get better, to improve, to keep fighting and driving ever onward and upward in these ways. And this morning, the phrase from our Marks of a True Christian is no different in its challenge to us and in its importance within the life of the church, and that is, do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit. But before we go any further, I want to go back, like we always do, look at where we are going with this series and, of course, where we have been. The marks of a true Christian, according to Paul, Romans 12, verses 9 through 21. Reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal, be ardent in spirit, serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints, extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you, bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. No, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink, for by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. That's where we've been and where we're going. So do not lag in zeal and be ardent in spirit. Before we start, I'd like to look at the words of our verse this morning. Two words, I think, stand out because we rarely use them in our everyday speech. One is zeal, and the other is ardent. Zeal is a little bit more familiar. The dictionary says that zeal is eagerness and ardent interest in the pursuit of something. And there is that other word, ardent, of course, right in there. Now, the dictionary describes ardent as characterized by warmth of feeling, typically expressed in eager, zealous support or activity, and there is that word zeal in zealous. Do you see why I kept this verse together and intact? They're both taking a look at the same idea. The dictionary gave similar synonyms for both: fiery, fervor, hot. The Greek root for the word translated as ardent is the verb leo, which means to boil. Literally, leontes, which is translated in the NRV as ardent, means boiling over, as if out of control. Sounds a little bit like the root also for lion, and perhaps that's a good image for our minds as well. And perhaps not the lion that you see lying in the shade in the zoo, or in the shade of an African savanna somewhere instead, but the symbolic, mythical lion, majestic, strong, and true, of one mind, the lion on the hunt, intent, energetic, and completely focused on the task. I want to read to you two different descriptions of churches, both of which are written by those from outside, voicing their perspective of the goings-on within the church. I want to try for you to try to figure out which one is the Presbyterian church and which one is not. The first: the church has spread with its appeal focused especially on the common people, The churches are convened sometimes by mere enthusiasts who, in these meetings, read sundry fanatical books and use long extemporary prayers and discourses, sometimes by itinerant strolling ministers, and at present by a permanent preacher who is well known to be intimate with known evangelical rabble-rousers. Their sole purpose is to spread their religion to all parts of this colony, using emotional frenzy, undermining the true church at every step. That's the first. Here's the second. The church is in a low state. A surprising negligence appears in attending on public worship, and an equally surprising levity and unconcernedness in those who attend. Godliness is not common. There is a general malaise in the congregation. The sermons are dull, and thus people are contented by the stale teachings from the pulpit. Which is the Presbyterian church? As described in those passages. Is the Presbyterian church the one described as filled with emotional frenzy? Or is the Presbyterian church the one that's described as stale and dead? People on the outside never quite get it. Many look at Presbyterians today and stereotype us in certain ways. The term frozen, chosen, comes to mind. But so do we. We do the same thing. Of course, these descriptions they're of our church and the Elevate Church, right, in Windsor, the new vibrant kid on the block where all the young folks are going there. I've heard it here said it's just emotion, just touchy-feely, promise, Christmas, not Christianity, prosperity, gospel, good feeling stuff. And they might describe us in the way of the second stale and dead, outdated and old. But the truth is, these two descriptions are not from churches today. And yes, one is Presbyterian. And in fact, the first one is the one that's Presbyterian. They both come from 1730s. The vibrant one, the one that is described as a frenzy. Now, of course, those are descriptions from an outsider. But how interesting the roles could be reversed, at least for us. The first is a description of what was going on in Hanover, Virginia, at the upstart Presbyterian congregation at Pole Green under the pastorship of the Reverend Samuel Davies in the 1740s and 50s. It was written by the description was written by the pastor of the other church being described, the Reverend Patrick Henry, the uncle and namesake of the Liberty or Death guy that we know so well. Who felt threatened by the upstart church, and though his church was the state-sponsored Anglican church, sponsored by the crown and the colony, and the others were the dissenters, he still felt threatened because his church had become stale and dead, and he knew it. It's interesting how the stale and dead church always likes to point fingers at the other one and tell them that they are wrong. I remember when I was at Blue Ridge, we were always the little brother of Woodbury Forest, and we talked about them and how horrible they were all the time. I'm sure they never even mentioned us. And when I pointed that out, everybody got mad at me. I'm sure the Elevate Church doesn't mention us either. But what accounts for the change from fervor and enthusiasm to the other? To get back on track, one church is not lagging in zeal, and the other one is. One church is ardent in the spirit, and the other one is not. Now, why is this so important, other than the obvious? To answer that question, I want to look at the gospel and then the New Testament lessons. The first, out of Christ's own mouth, is the Sermon on the Mount, as presented to us in Matthew chapter 5, verses 13 to 16. You are the salt of the earth, but if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. No one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under the bushel basket, but on a lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. We've heard that before, that the job of the church, the job of the Christian, the job of the disciple of Christ, is to let our lights shine before others so that they may see us and give glory to God. Our light to be lit and held on a lampstand. And that brings us to our second reading, this one from Revelation, the John of Patmos letter to the church at Ephesus, one of the seven churches that he writes to open up the book of Revelation. This is chapter 2, verses 1 to 5. To the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these are the words of him who holds the seven stars in his right hand and walks among the seven golden lampstands. I know your deeds, your hard work, and your perseverance. I know that you cannot tolerate wicked people, that you have tested those who claim to be apostles but are not, and have found them false. You have persevered and have endured hardships for my name and have not grown weary. Yet I hold this against you. You have forsaken the love you had at first. Consider how far you have fallen. Repent and do the things you did at first. If you do not repent, I will come to you and remove your lampstand from its place. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I was at a presbytery meeting of Presbytery of Eastern Virginia, actually. It was where I became a candidate for ministry. You go through these stages. The first is inquirer, and then candidate. Each time you move up, you go before the entire presbytery. This one occasion was nice because it was at the church of which I was under care, which is the way that they talk, the church that you are a member of. And they were sponsoring me, for lack of a better term. And that was First Presbyterian Church in Gloucester, which actually has since left the presbytery, ironically. But at this meeting, the speaker of the worship part of the meeting was talking about churches who have lost it. He was all about church growth and church vitality, but he was talking about the churches that just didn't make it. And he quoted this passage from Revelation, and he used it as a metaphor that all churches have a candle. And little things happen over time that just snuff out the candle, snuff out the light. And it was funny, my dad and I were sitting next to each other for the rest of the meeting, and anytime the typical Presbyterian bureaucratic groupthink was going on, we would look at each other and go, we need funding for this. Whoa. We need to cut funding for this. There will be another mission study to look at how churches can do better at this. A new committee must be formed to discuss whether or not the flag in the presbytery office should be moved from the main hall to a more prominent place. Ah, who cares? And it was just like most meetings, right? Because these were insignificant things and everybody was getting up and voicing their opinion. Have you ever been in a meeting where everybody cares as if it is the number one topic of concern while the meeting is going on? But before the meeting and after the meeting, nobody really cares. It's over. Back to work. That candle became a metaphor for the zeal of the church, the ardency of the Spirit. But how does it happen? How does a church go from a zealous church to a church with a flickering lampstand, a candle in the wind? I'm not sure, but I have my suspicions because I know what robs me of my zeal. One is when people are put in a box and not allowed to be themselves. If I were to hear those two descriptions of church from either, the live one and the dead one, I wouldn't have wanted to be either, because I would want to defy the description that some outsider who doesn't know me was saying. That's not me. I am more than that. You can't label me accurately because you don't know me. You can't fence me in. There is more to me than what you think. Because I'm always growing, learning, changing by the experiences that I have. People, by design, are dynamic and created by God to be such. So any labels, descriptions, expectations of me or of other people, they snuff out my candle. I believe that individuals were uniquely created by God in his image, and God defies all labels. And God cannot be put into a box. And so how could his reflection? The next is similar. I don't like it when someone is not allowed to live up to their potential. And it's similar to the other one because labels are one of the most popular ways that people tend to stifle the potential of others. I used to hate it when my students had over time developed an understanding of their abilities and their identities that were always less than what they could have actually been. They had been taught or led to believe that this, whatever it was all that they could do, or even less. Which brings me to my third thing that snuffs me out, and that is when systems are put in place to make sure, to make it so a person doesn't have to live up to their potential. The creation of crutches that make excelling no longer necessary. One of my favorite poems gets at this, T.S. Eliot. This is Choruses from the Rock. It's so good. But this one part says, they constantly, talking about human beings, they constantly try to escape from the darkness outside and within by dreaming of systems so perfect that no one will need to be good. How true that statement is of our world. How many systems have we tried to create that just so that no one needs to be good anymore? And the cynical piece is that, you know, that happy facial part that everybody says on the front is that, oh, we're just trying to help. But the cynical piece is that what it is saying underneath is that they can't be good. And so they need to be helped. They don't have what it takes. People can be better, but often we don't let them be. Because we make it so that they don't have to be. I see this, and my candle gets snuffed out. Or else, I seek to fight it head on. My candle stays burning. And I'm fighting against it, and my candle is burning hotter and hotter. But when I give up, and when I give in, there it goes. And it's a hard battle. Now you may ask yourself, how does this happen in church then? What does your pet peeve about individualism have to do with church, Pete? Now, I think that the same scenarios take place over time within a church. You get used to each other. And you get used to the things as they are. And you don't see them or each other as dynamic anymore. And you get used to the labels. You know each other so well that you put each other in boxes. Oh, you know him, he's just that way. Or she's just that way. You create systems that sustain the life of the organization by creating as little conflict as possible. Oh, the Presbyterian Church is so full of those. We have this big, thick book called the Book of Order, and it is completely and mostly designed to try and prevent old conflicts from happening again. But it does work. No, but it makes us fearful of conflict and robs us of our zeal. We stop challenging each other to be constantly changing and alive and vibrant and supportive because we are more interested in keeping everyone happy and safe. And slowly the zeal of truly rising constantly to our potential collectively and potentials individually in an ever upward growth pattern becomes stagnant. It happens in organizations and it happens in families. People get used to each other and then they expect each other to always be the same. And in most cases, they demand that people remain the same. And as the people, so goes the institution. The other way it happens is also connected, because the church takes on a label and an identity of itself rather than one being one of vitality and building. It becomes one of holding on. So fearful of decline that you hold on. Someone starts a new program, and it's their baby, and they love it, and they're fired up about it, and they do it well, but then they die. Or move away or stop, and it of course needs to continue or the church is going to fall apart. It's what we do here, right? But no one else is quite as fired up about the original person. They try and keep it going because they're good, dutiful Christians, but they aren't that other person, and it becomes a burden. It becomes a must-do instead of a want-to-do, and must flows from the label, not the actual dynamic personality of someone, right? I am here, a member of Bethany Church, so I should pick up the slack as a church member. It is my duty. But your gifts and talents and interests are elsewhere. But what happens to us if we let those things go? What is our identity without it? This is the baggage that is constantly being built up. It weighs a church down because it weighs its people down. Do you know the line that follows the one about building systems so that people will not have to be good? It is this: but the man that is shall shadow the man that pretends to be. The man that is. Who are you? Not who do people think you're supposed to be. Not what other people have been so you think you have to emulate it. Not what the church down the street is doing. Who are you? Stop pretending and be what you are, because everything else will destroy and lower your zeal eventually. It is the death knell of any church, because a church is not the building. A church is not the steeple. I think there's a song that goes like this. But a church is a people. And stagnant, pigeonholed shells of people lag in zeal and are not ardent in the spirit. It's the bunny story that I read to the kids during children's time. I don't know how the clothes got on, but they are there, and you can't be a bunny again until you take them off. And if you leave them, beware, because danger is always lurking. This Sunday, today, it's Reformation Sunday, because it was on October 31st that Martin Luther nailed his theses to the door in Wittenberg. He was reacting to the same situation. Over the years, the Catholic Church had added things to what it meant to be a church and what it meant to be a Christian. And Luther wanted to strip those things away and get at what it truly meant. He said, not the works, but instead faith. Not the priest, but the priesthood of all believers. Not tradition, but sola scriptura, only scripture. He wanted to get back to the original. These principles he used to use to get back to what was essential to the faith, and the rest had to be stripped away. And it was difficult, and wars were fought over that. Calvin took it a few steps further, parallel to Luther in Geneva, and he added his idea to the Reformed faith, saying, Ecclesia semper reformanda est, reformed and always reforming. Knowing that churches and people have a tendency to add things to themselves that separate them from the light, airy, bad, baggage-less discipleship that we are actually called to do. What we need to do here at Bethany and in many churches across this country, what we need to do is get back to the essentials about what makes us, which is why I've been going through these marks of a Christian. For they are challenging ways to get us to think again about what the standard is, how it is impossible, how the standard is impossible, and how we must dynamically be constantly fighting and moving upward, not to attain it, but to be constantly working towards it. I want to read another part of Chorus that's from The Rock for you. This is earlier when Eliot is talking about what the work of a human actually is. He says, the lot of man is ceaseless labor, a never-ending battle. He writes this: let me show you the work of the humble. Listen. In the vacant places we build with new bricks. Where the bricks are fallen, we build with new stone. Where the beams are rotten, we build with new timbers. Where the word is unspoken, we will build with new speech. There is a work together, a church for all, and a job for each, every man to his work. What life have you if not our life together? There is not life that is not community, and no community not lived in praise of God. Some people would say that we need to update the program. Here, appeal to younger audiences. Pull out the pews, stop singing old traditional hymns, and be more like Elevate. I disagree absolutely, completely, and wholeheartedly, because you will not get any closer to being yourself by trying to copy what somebody else is doing.
Amen.
It is not about them. It never was about them. It is about us. And I believe to my heart that a church unapologetically doing what they are called to be and being who they are is a dynamic church, And it is dynamic churches that survive. One trying to be someone else will always fail every time. One who is always shadows over one who merely pretends to be. What is central to us as this community living in praise of God? What is essential? How can we get back to the basics? They are the questions, and we let the rest go. Shed it like the clothes that have slowed down the bunny. Lay those burdens not on ourselves, but on Christ. There has been a repeated theme week after week since I've been preaching here. Have you noticed it? It comes back every time to faith, gratitude, and love. Faith that God has made us, saved us, and is sustaining us through his sovereign and perfect will, and therefore who he has made us to be is who we should strive to be, and pretending to be no one else for the next is gratitude, and not being who you are is not living in gratitude. God's will is good for us and better than we can ever do in shaping ourselves, and how it then frees us only to love for those who we walk life with. Because those people we walk with are just as created with the same boundless potential, and though they be like us in some ways, are completely and always utterly unique and different. Faith, gratitude, and love is a good place to start. Why not leave the rest behind? It is of note that the church in Ephesus has their lampstand removed, not because they're not doing a good job, but simply because they lost their love. It is essential, and without it, we are lost. And speaking of lost, the meditation in the bulletin comes from Paradise Lost, from the mouth of Satan, of all characters. This is for once, because he is alone in his thoughts, and it's for just this split moment in the entire book that he shows regret for the fall. Nor was his service hard. What could be less than to afford him praise, the easiest recompense, and pay him thanks, the debt immense of endless gratitude, so burdensome, still paying, still to owe, forgetful from him that I still received, and understood not that a grateful mind by owing owes not, but still pays, at once indebted and discharged. What burden then? Remember when we were defining love, I said that love is a cup that is never empty. It is always running over. It has the energy to replace itself. That is what zeal is. That's what being ardent in the Spirit is. A grateful mind owes, but owes not, but still pays, and at once is indebted and discharged all at once. What burden is left? If we are truly living just the essentials and not all the extra stuff, our zeal should never flag, and we should remain ever ardent in the Spirit. May God bless us and make that be so.